what can be said about Phoebe Ann Moses that hasn't been written 1,000 times before? Simply put, the petite sharpshooter's image came to define a woman of the Old West and wove itself deep into the tapestry that is American legend. But the persona of Annie Oakley is only a single part of the complex, fascinating life and personality so dichotomous, one might be hard-pressed to believe it's not its own Wild West folktale. Her life began in rural Ohio to a family so destitute, her mother sent her to live at a local poorhouse where she'd be hired out as live-in help. It began a 2-year period where Annie suffered terrible abuse and worked nearly as a slave for a couple her autobiography only refers to as the Wolves. When she again lived with her family at 15, she taught herself to shoot. Not only did Annie put meat on the table, but she was so proficient that she was able to sell additional quail to the town grocer and local hotels. Even at this tender age, Annie was already defying everything expected of her. Not only was she the primary breadwinner as a child, but also as a young woman. A young woman with a gun, no less, in a time when such practices weren't always smiled upon. Her persistent smashing of social mores continued nearly her entire life. She once bested a man at trap shooting, a traveling professional marksman named Frank Butler, who was immediately taken by the lady shooter. They would be married within a year. Eventually, the husband-wife duo would travel performing exhibition shooting, but it wouldn't take long for Annie to become the star of the show, with Frank serving as her manager, assistant, and press agent. Again, Annie was smashing social norms, with her husband taking the back seat. They would often perform alongside the bawdy and titillating vaudeville acts of the era, but Oakley was determined to keep her reputation pristine. She would be clad from head to toe, even wearing a hat, gloves, full-length dress, and tall boots. It would become almost as signature as her shooting. Annie's reputation was growing, but it would soon explode as she became part of Buffalo Bill's Wild West show. Joining the show in 1885, she was initially billed low, but audiences loved the 5-foot-tall lady shooter and her act. She was pretty, demure, sweet, with a wardrobe that catered to the Victorian sensibilities of the time, while her act of a woman skilled in shooting also challenged those same societal expectations. In 1886, Annie performed with Buffalo Bills in Madison Square Garden. By 1887, they were performing at the Golden Jubilee for Queen Victoria herself and were seen by many of the European heads of state. She was the darling of Manhattan and London. It is said that Annie earned more than any performer, save Buffalo Bill himself. It was another social rule shattered by Annie as easily as her glass ball targets. It was this wide exposure to Annie at home and abroad that cemented her as part of American folklore and legend. Here was a girl from Ohio who'd not by any account been a pioneer nor spent a night on the cattle trail, but who had become the image of the Western woman. She embodied the rugged individualism so valued by Americans, but never at the expense of her femininity nor demeanor. She was fierce, competitive, driven, and a talent like none other. A tornado of determination wrapped in a beaming smile and a dress. She performed with Buffalo Bill at the 1889 Universal Exposition in Paris and again at the 1893 Columbian Exposition in Chicago. While Buffalo Bill Cody was famously not invited to perform at the latter, he set up his show outside and proceeded to outshine the exposition itself. It was the Old West versus all the brightest innovations and best inventions the world could offer. The West won. Yes, Annie Oakley and Buffalo Bill's Wild West were flying high through the 19th century, but after the Wild West show's traveling train was involved in a significant wreck in 1901, Annie left the show for quieter pastures. However, the allure show business proved too strong, and within a year, she was working again, but this time on stage. In 1902, she was performing in a show titled The Western Girl, in a role written especially for her. It closed in March 1903, and later that same month, Annie Oakley received this elaborate factory presentation rifle by Marlin Firearms. Annie was well known to use Marlin rifles in her act, In fact, one of her favorites was a slide-action 22 Marlin model 1891. But this was clearly not your ordinary Marlin. It is fully plated in gold and smothered in Marlin grade number 10 engraving, a wonderful grape leaf and vine motif that surrounds the detailed wildlife panel scenes. Even the barrel, hammer, and lever received this superb combination of engraving and gold. Tipped with a German silver blade front sight at the end of its matted top flat, it is all lovingly set into a deluxe walnut forearm and pistol grip stock with fancy fleur-de-lis checkering accented with smooth circles. Of course, what truly sets this Marlin 1897 apart is the silver shield on the buttstock with the factory presentation inscription that reads, "Presented to Annie Oakley, Little Sure Shot, by Marlin Firearms, New Haven, Connecticut, March 23rd, 1903. In our research, this is the first of two engraved and gold-plated model 1897 rifles presented to Annie by Marlin Firearms, with the other presented 3 years later in 1906. This is the rifle of an American legend. A woman so ingrained with America's Wild West identity, her image is indelibly part of its history. She grew up destitute and performed for royalty. She was a Victorian woman, yet epitomized the Wild West. She shattered gender roles, yet remained a proper lady. She fought for what she believed was right, worked hard to improve her place in life, was guided by a strong moral compass, and shone with self-determination. Annie Oakley was 19th century America, and this golden, extraordinary factory presentation Marlin is a tangible link to the single most famous sharpshooting legend of the West.